I have 559 also. What are you doing?
Welcome, everybody, to this week's Meowie Hour. I'm your host, Arden Moore, and here's one of the co-hosts, Pet Safety Cat, Casey. Hey, guys, paws up, and maybe flying in because I have a treat. Here comes Rusty the Performer. Rusty, come on, buddy. He's right there. Yay. I'm sorry, I got to eat first. Again, as always, this show is presented by Cat Fancier Association. I am delighted today, our co-pilots from CFA, a couple of all-breed cat judges. Give it up for Kathy Black. Woo! Woo! Hiding behind that beautiful picture, Teresa Kiger. Woo! She is also the editor of Cat Talk. Also in the CFA family today, back, is Ann Mathis. She is an all-breed judge. And Ann, what's the breed you're going to talk about later on the show?
I had to unmute. I will be talking about the Oriental.
Oriental, awesome. And you guys, you know her. She's helping people with more than one cat in their household all over the planet. A very knowledgeable and fun multi-cat behavior expert and columnist for Castor Magazine. Let's raise a big purr for Rita Reimers. Hey, Rita.
Hi, everyone. And Sonny is here eating treats so I can keep him on camera.
See, bribery works. Bribery works.
It does.
What we're also very delighted is you'll see in the upper corner, Pet King Brands is presenting this show. And their two key products, you guys know them, Zymox and Oratine. And during the show, when Ann is discussing about the Oriental, we're going to have a trivia contest and give away a huge gift basket. I don't know if, Kathy, do you have it up quick you can show just to tempt our viewers?
You bet. Look at all that stuff.
Nice. You're getting it, man. So we're going to have that. We thank them very much for sponsoring this show. I can tell you I've used Zymox for my dogs. I had Big Bujo, had a very bad skin infection, and working with my veterinarian, and we use this product. She's all cleared up, and her skin is nice and shiny. And Oratine, there's different ways to keep your cat having perfect oral hygiene. So we're going to talk more about that too.
And some now that we support cream also, which is always.
Oh, yes. Thank you. Yes, for healthy skin. I do think I'm going to put Teresa on the spot. Teresa, can you come back? Teresa, hey, yeah, come back. Can you talk about how you use Zymox on your kitty?
Oh, my goodness. Remember Phoebe?
Yeah.
Here we go. Miss Phoebe has a couple of sores. She scratches herself with her ears, around her chin and everything. And that's exactly where I use it. What I like is that it not only helps it heal, it helps loosen up some of the crusty stuff there, and it doesn't irritate her.
Yeah, and the nice thing is, guys, these products have been around a long time and they're veterinarian approved. So they've got the science behind it and they've got the folks in the white coats with stethoscopes behind it. So again, Pet King Brands, these are the two headliners of their product line, and we're delighted that they're sponsoring today's show. Which brings me to this. We're going to have a little kickoff. How many of you laugh that you buy your cat the world's biggest cat tree, or you give them a beautiful, spacious cat bed, and the packing materials with the tiny boxes or in your kitchen sink or other places, that's where your cat prefers?
Yes.
So we're going to solve that mystery later with Rita Reimers, our guest. But right now, just to get you into the Meowie Hour mood, with the help of my co-pilot, Kathy Black, we found this fun video about all these cats and what they do when you get all those darn shipping boxes. Does that sound familiar during COVID?
Oh, yes. Here we go.
I love that cat.
Beautiful.
This kitty may not win it for balance. Oh, there you go.
I love this exotic.
All right, yeah, you guys are the cat breed experts. Shout out these breeds when you see them. Look at that.
Beautiful.
Yep, that's an exotic.
Sounds like Elvis. Can you turn the volume up a little?
I got the volume all the way up.
Okay. So this person arranged all these boxes, guys. What do you think?
I love it. It's like a big cat.
It's like a lot of fun.
So pretty soon near about the...
That is my cat.
Yeah. She's going to get it to the end, near the... She's doing great. So let's see what happens when she gathers about 8 or 10 cats.
Okay, we're going to fast forward.
There, right there, right there. That's good. Check this out, guys.
Oh, my goodness. I have to try this.
This is like the Hollywood Squares.
Good one, Teresa. They're all chasing just one feather wand toy. All right, let's give it up for these cats in boxes. Thank you, Kathy. And let's show a few of the photos, that still photos that I found. And I want you, all of our team, to kind of give us a tight spot that you found your cat likes to cuddle in. So, Kathy, if you don't mind, we've got that picture of Casey and Rusty, you know, on the cat tree. If you have that one.
Yes.
And please ignore how much this cat tree has been shredded. But look at this. This was the first time my older cat, pet safety cat, Casey, finally said, okay, welcome, little brother, to the household. So there's a lot of places for them to nap. But what do you guys think of that photo?
It looks like a heart.
Oh, mm-hmm. My gosh, you're right. It does. Look at that. And they love each other. So I'm happy. That was my sign that, okay, all is good in the Moore household. Let's go ahead and surprise me with the next one. Okay. Aww. This one is actually a kitten in a boot.
In a boot.
How many of you have ever had a cat in a boot? Now, you have?
Yes.
What do you think it is? They just love your stinky foot smell or what?
Well, this is fur lined, so that's nice and warm and snuggly. But I actually had my 12-pound cat try to fit into an iPhone box. It was like this big.
Really?
It was hilarious. And so they like to get into the tiniest spaces.
So, all right, let's see the next one.
Like an egg crate.
This one, pardon me, is cracking myself up. The yolk's on you, Rusty says. I wonder why this kitty likes the feeling, the substrate of an egg carton box.
I think it's just the right size for that little kitten.
All right, let's go with another one.
Now this is, hopefully this is not on the stove.
Do not put this kitty on medium. Do not simmer. We do have an expert in the house, a multi-cat behavior expert, Rita Reimers. So when you see that video, Rita, and you see all these kitties trying to squeeze into the tightest of places, what's going on in that feline mind?
Cats get comfort and security in small spaces, you know, out in nature. They are both hunted and hunter. So in order to avoid becoming someone's breakfast or dinner, they can contort themselves to fit into a small space, and they tend to feel more secure and hidden and protected from predators when they're in a smaller space. When they're in a larger space, it's more dangerous for them.
All right, see, we got the expert in the house. What's a cool little spot you found one of your cats, Rita?
Well, whenever I have the box of cat food cans and I get to the last one, and you know those boxes are not very big. No. They love to try to squeeze into that tiny little box that had the canned food in it. The smaller, the better.
It smells good. It probably has still the residue smell of the food, so they're having food dreams.
And then I get the cat lady box, you know, that always has a catnip toy in it. So they want the toys, but they really want that empty box so they can curl up in that box and smell the catnip that used to be in it. They love those.
It doesn't matter what came in the box. They always want to get in the box.
Yes, yes.
And I think that cats are kind of happy about this pandemic because we're home. We're not really shopping in stores. We're ordering everything from Chewy.com to Amazon. So our house is full of beautiful cat treasures called cardboard boxes. Mm-hmm. What's the deal with cats that like to chew the cardboard?
I just think that's play behavior. You know, they love to get into as much trouble as they can. A lot of the scratching is, you know, for their paw health. So that right. You might find them scratching on the boxes just like they do their scratching posts. But I think chewing the box is just part of good fun of, you know, ripping something up and not being told no.
That's I thought I was being time. Insulted for being a terrible cat cook or something. And they were like, cardboard tastes a lot better than her chow. You
know? Well, I don't know. I haven't been to your house, but maybe there's some truth to that.
I'm just kidding. So that's kind of our funny for the today. Yeah, Teresa.
Yeah, I've got something I'd like to share in this line. If Kathy will let me share.
Yeah, take the stage.
Yeah, it fits right in. Here.
I'll make you a co-host.
Okay.
You know, so
this is one I very frequently find at my house.
Oh, yeah.
The 20-pound maintain in the small carrier.
I love that.
And he shuts the door behind him. He does that. It's his man cave.
That's great.
You know what? I think I love it when a cat loves a carrier because, you guys, we can't think of it as a punishment. We can't get all hyperventilating when it's time to go. The three C's, the car, the clinic, and the carrier, make it so it's like a kitty condo. And that way they might find it as a nice getaway to snooze in, get away from the dogs and the other kids. Don't you agree, Rita?
Oh, absolutely. I have carriers out all the time, and there's usually somebody napping in one. I'll put some catnip toys in there, maybe a couple treats, so they feel like it's a secure space for them. So when you have to take them to the vet, they're already accustomed to being in it. It's a secure space for them, and they don't fight it.
I like it. Now, we're getting ready for the first trivia of the night, and this is a general trivia. We're gonna give away two prizes. Drum roll, please. I'm going to autograph and give you guys an autographed copy of my book, Fit Cat, Tips and Tricks to Give Your Pet a Longer, Healthier, Happier Life. Think of it, it was written with the idea of meeting the wants and needs of your 21st century cat. And I know Kathy's going to take over. Kathy, how are we going to do this?
All right. So we're going to do one from the Zoom and one from Facebook.
Okay, so here comes the trivia question. What famous cat-loving person was quoted as saying, and if you know the answer, Rita, don't shout it out.
No, I won't.
A, was quoted as saying, dogs have their day, but cats have 365 days. Power to the paw, power to the paw. So who said that? Was it A, Lillian Jackson Braun, B, Ernest Hemingway, C, Mark Twain, or D, Jules Verne? Again, your choices are, the first three are cat authors, as you know. Lillian Jackson Braun, she's the one who did all those, the cat who mysteries. Ernest Hemingway, of course, proving that real dudes love cats. And the famous Hemingway house is in the Florida Keys. And we've got Mark Twain. He was a big cat fan, as C. And D, Jules Verne. Now, was he an author too, or was he just Mr. Space Guy? Jules Verne, D.
No, anybody here? He
okay, so they're all authors. So the question again is, dogs have their day, but cats have 365. Lillian Jackson Braun, Ernest Hemingway, Mark Twain, or Jules Verne?
All right, you'll get type your answer in the chat.
Yeah, I get to see people coming in with this. And tell your friends. Now, we're going to announce it in a couple days because a lot of times we get a big audience right after the show. So you guys are still have a shot at it, right, Kathy?
Yes, and real quickly, let me name my winners from last week. I have Andrea Dorn, Jenny Wickle, who says she's going to donate her prize to someone.
Oh, that's nice.
I have Cynthia Jones, and these are your names on Facebook or on Zoom. So this may not be your real name, but it's the name that was on. Cynthia Jones, Haley Hall, and Holly Dustin. And I've only heard from two of them now, two of the five. So ladies, please contact me so you can get your free CCW registration. Or if you're already registered, you'll get your card. So,
and that again stands for Community Cat World, which is the new program.
Community Companion.
Yeah. Companion Cat World. Yeah. I must have been smoking some catnip before the show. That probably was it. Cat World.
Don't tell everything.
Oh, sorry. And this, a big player in creating that is right here, Kathy Black from CFA. And we're going to talk more about CCW at the end of the show, but it's recognizing household cats. And it's pretty cool. My two cats are proud card-carrying members of the CCW. So congratulations, ladies, on winning.
Real quick programming note. Everyone who joined us last week to hear the president of CFA, Daryl Burke, we are going to reschedule Daryl with a Q&A session where he's going to answer your questions in an upcoming Meowie Hour. So look for that to come in
November 11th. Now, I'm going to be non-partisan right now, guys. Everybody, don't hiss. Despite what happened yesterday as a presidential debate, this one is going to be perfect. Yes. People are going to be well-mannered. And we are going to solicit now, start sending in your questions you've always wanted to ask. Daryl Newkirk is going to be back, and he's going to help people that are part of the CFA and people that are interested in going to a cat show, maybe having a cat that isn't a pedigree, but they want to do the household. So start sending us some questions, because we're going to get about 10 or 12 of them. And the good president, Daryl Newkirk, is going to answer them. So that was a great idea from Kathy Black. And I think that would be a nice thing to have on Veterans Day, November 11th. So we're teeing it up now to let you guys know. And we're happy he's coming back. He's a cool guy.
Yes.
What do you guys think? All right.
Okay, can move on now.
All right. So we are now ready to properly introduce our special guest today. When it comes to cats, she knows them from the kitten to the primetime to the senior. And she has an extensive credential background. Yes, you pray, you're like, oh, that name, Rita Reimers. Yeah, I know that name. Why? Because every issue of Catster, she is a contributing editor, and she also gets behind the microphone. She and I are on the same network, Pet Life Radio, and she has a new podcast I hope you all will go to and tune in. It's called 19 Cats and Counting, but this is Catster, and every issue she does the new Catitude column for about 18 years, guys. She was also running a cat-only successful professional pet sitting business called Just for Cats Pet Sitting. She is now on the director of Meowtel, which we're going to find out what that means. She's written a book. She's had articles in Chewy.com, PetMD, Pet Central, lots of things. And during this, we're going to find out what the heck was her connection to Richard Simmons.
Oh, Richard Simmons.
Simmons. Yeah, so let's start with that. So
love Richard.
Let's do the time machine back.
Okay.
In the 70s and 80s.
Put those red shorts on.
I worked for him for a while. I met Richard way back in, I want to say 2001, when I took my mom. He used to do these Mother's Day events in the Poconos, and I took my mom, and I had just been through a horrible, divorce, and I had gained weight, blah, blah. So my mom encouraged me to write him a letter, which I did. I slipped it under his door. A lot of other people were encouraging me to do that. So then the next day at the event, he comes running up to me. Rita Reimers, I got your letter. I read every word.
Wait a minute, do a Richard Simmons running up to you.
Well, it's really hard to, well, yeah, but he was more subdued at that time. Okay. You know, okay. Richard. But what he was telling me, you're going to write to me. I'm going to help you. You're going to lose the weight. Flash forward to 2003. I moved out to Los Angeles after I got laid off from a job. And while I was still working in my old profession, I started Just for Cats Pet Sitting. Richard asked me to associate produce his radio show on Sirius, which was called Lighten Up with Richard Simmons. They were live for 3 hours every Sunday, and we helped a lot of people. And I also produced his special that's called Love Yourself and Win. I'm in that. I produced it for him. All the while he was mentoring me, you know, helping me select the name for my company. We used to be called Cats 90210, and he actually helped me select that.
Oh, nice. Nice.
So when I moved back to the Carolinas, I needed something that was, would fit both coasts because had started one here. So then I did, Just for Cats Pet Sitting.
What was something nice you liked about that most people may not know? I mean, obviously you're good friends.
Well, Richard's kind of, you know, he's become a private person now, so I can contact him. In fact, I contacted him not long ago when our mutual friend Linda Hall, her son-in-law passed away, and I got a message to him about that. So I can contact him if I need to. I still have his home phone number, but he's really made it clear he's a private person now. He gave so much of himself all those years.
No, I mean in his heyday, what was something you liked about him that, you know?
He just was always upbeat and positive. And, you know, he would have an event and he would stay until every single person got an autograph or got everybody in line, make sure he spoke to everyone. He didn't want anyone to go away disappointed. So now I'm getting emotional because
he always had a big heart.
He did. He does still. It's just, you know, he gave so much of himself for so long, you know, physical issues with his knees. But, you know, if you needed him, he was there for you. He called 50 people every single day. He and his assistant, Michelle, who was a good friend of mine, too. Lots of shut-in people. He was their only connection to the world.
Nice.
You know?
Yeah. Well, back in the day, he and Jane Fonda were kind of the aerobic dynamic duel, don't you think?
Oh, yeah, absolutely. In fact, Ann Sorkowski, who was Richard's kinesiologist, also worked for Jane.
Oh.
So, you know, at the same time for a while, and then first she worked for Richard, then she was working for Jane and Richard, and then she came back to stick with just Richard because he really needed someone who understood him, you know, because he's very unique and his aerobic style is very unique, you know.
Yeah. Well, I know we're not going to talk about kitty aerobics today, but how did you get into the world of cats? And now you're one of the leading authorities on cat behavior in our country.
Oh,
so
well, you're sweet to say that. Thank you. I've always loved cats. When I was a child, I would get too close to them. You know, my mom would be like, oh, don't get too close to your face. They're going to scratch your face. I'm like, no, they won't. I am a cat. So I made my mom dress me as a cat every Halloween. My grandfather gave me my first kitty when I was, I want to say I was seven or eight. But we couldn't keep him because my dad was allergic. So I grew up with a wonderful dog, lab golden mix named Blazer, and I love dogs too, but I have more of an intuitive understanding of cats and their behaviors, and plus they fit in better with what used to be a very hectic lifestyle for me. I used to travel quite a bit. I don't do that anymore, but kind of hard to have a dog unless you take them on every trip.
Unless they practice Kegels or something. Yeah, I gotcha. Now, with your Just for Cats Pet Sitting, you ran that for a number of years.
And
you
did 2 years.
You did that ahead of the time. You're ahead of your time because now there's more and more professional pet sitters that are just sitting and providing services for cats only, but I think you're one of the pioneers in that. So tell us a little bit about that now with your connection with Meowtel.
We were one of the premier cats only pet sitting services. In fact, a couple of my friends said, oh, you'll never make any money unless you do dogs too. And I'm like, that's not true. I just felt in my heart, people who are cat people that some of them don't like dogs, you know, and they kind of appreciate that you don't come to a cat sit smelling like you've been walking 18 dogs, you know.
Oh, I smell a German Shepherd on you and a pug.
Right.
Get out of here.
I love them both, but you know, those people really appreciate that we understood cats. You know, we knew how to approach them. It's a different approach than dogs, you know, because you've got both dogs and cats. Mm-hmm. Especially when a cat is new to you, you know, you're going into a strange home with cats that don't know you. Sometimes you get to meet them once because the pet parent is leaving the next day and they haven't given it much thought. So you get a quick introduction to the cat with the owner there. And then when you come back alone, it's a totally different cat, right? Sometimes not so good. So the fact that we knew,
stogies,
right?
Some bourbon.
What are you doing in my house?
What were some of the unique hiding places a cat would be in one of your clients' house? Because you got to count noses.
Yeah, I do have to count noses. And I had one. It was our only cat situation, but she was hard to find. She was black. And she would, like, they had a whole shelving unit in the living room. The whole wall was shelves. And she would hide behind the black clock on the shelf. And she was black. So it was really hard to spot her. But after I figured out where she liked to hide, it was a little bit easier. So that was a good hiding spot.
I can see you coming in with like night goggles, you know, looking for the infrared, you know. Mm-hmm. Oh, there's the cat.
Well, after a while, you know, because we know cats and how it takes them a while to get used to us. And, you know, and I say we because all of our sitters did the same things that I taught them. We would sit and talk and, you know, read our email out loud, give them some treats, what have you. Good. By the second or third day, they'd be at the door waiting for us.
Nice. So. We just saw a white and black cat just walk behind you. Who is that, sweetheart?
That was Sunny. Did he just go across? Sunny, yeah. I have his sister, Smoochie, who's a three-legged cat. I've had them since they were 4 weeks old. I got called by the director of the Lancaster shelter here in South Carolina. They were going to have to euthanize her because of her leg unless I took her, blah, blah. Well, here they are.
Yeah, well, hey, if I was a three-legged cat, I would be like, I won the kitty lottery because I'm with Rita Reimers. It's not a bad gig. Now, one of the things I really enjoy is every issue of Catster, which used to be called Cat Fancy.
Right.
You write the behavior column. I guess it's called New Catitude. You guys that are on live now, here is your chance, and I hope with the help of Kathy and Teresa, we're going to send some questions on behavior because we'll have Rita field a few of them. But tell us how long you've been doing that column and what's something, you know, that you've gotten a lot of reaction to.
Well, I've actually been doing that column since the first issue when they changed the name to Catster. And it was really luck that I ended up with it. Do you want me to give you the backstory of how I ended up writing?
Sure.
There used to be a website called Petcha, which was taken over by, remember that?
Yeah.
They were taken over by Chewy. It's now Pet Central. But at the time, that website was owned by the same people that used to publish Catster. So I had been called to do some videos for Petcha, some behavior videos. Mm-hmm. It was after I first moved here. And I thought, I said, I'd really love to, but I'm not in Los Angeles anymore. Darn. Wouldn't you know that the lady that ended up being my editor and helped me with the videos had just moved to Charlotte about 6 months before I did. Five miles away from me, she lived.
Wow.
So we did the videos. Yeah, I definitely think so. So we did the videos at her home. They turned out great. Next thing I know, she offered me this gig with Cubs.
Thanks. Well, I was looking at some of the past issues, and one of them I loved was personal space.
Yeah.
Can you talk about, from the cat's perspective during this pandemic, where a lot of people are working from home, kids are now doing their schoolwork, and the cat's like, I want to be Greta Garbo. I want to be alone. So what are some of the signs, because cats are more subtle than dogs, that they're kind of getting agitated by us being underfoot?
Yeah, at first, sure. well, my cats are used to me being home, but even me, you know, I don't leave as much as I used to at all. they look at me like, why are you sitting on my sofa? Why are you here? You know, cats spend a good deal of the day sleeping. That's what they do. They eat, they sleep. Well, actually, they hunt, they eat, they groom, they sleep. Those are their...
That's my kind of life, Nana.
Yeah, me too. So then you're home all day, and not only are they, you know, their routine's upset, because I don't know why you're home, why you're on the sofa where they like to sleep, but now they have to learn a whole new routine. And then, you know, if your cat, especially if your cat's really bonded to you, they're going to come and check on you several times during the day. Are you okay? What are you doing? You know, because they don't want to be left out of anything. So they're not getting the same sleep they used to. So I always recommend people, when you're working at home, and I do it too, start yourself in your office for a few hours. Let your cats chill out, relax, get some sleep. You can get some concentrated work done, you know, and then come together later on and have some playtime, you know. Because it's going to be stressful.
What are some signs a cat is going to display vocally or physically before they swat you so we don't get swatted?
Yeah, well, you'll
agitate it with us.
You'll hear that low guttural, you know, if you start, or even you feel the rumble, you may not even hear it. You know that they're getting a little agitated. Their ears will start going back flat.
Or they'll
you might even feel their body
very
stiffen.
Rapidly. Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah, Kathy, you're right.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Well, we have a graphic you sent us. It's a chart on how to properly pet a cat. And with the help of Kathy, could you pop up that on the screen and we'll do the audio with Rita?
Yeah. And I can't take credit for that. Somebody else actually created that chart, but that's pretty accurate. My cats love that, oh, hell yeah, spot down by the tail. They just love that. But you have to have a cat that trusts you. You can't, like, as a pet sitter, I couldn't walk up to a new cat and just go right for that spot. They're like, no.
That's the elevator button. When you hit that button, the elevator button.
Oh, yeah. I love elevator button. You have to be cat if he raises his tiny end. You know.
So let's talk about the good and then don't you dare. So we got the elevator butt. We got the cheeks. What
I
about,
love that because they've got the scent glands in their cheeks. So they love to rub that against you or actually even against objects in your home, like the corners of your wall. You'll find if you don't wash them down, they're going to have dark marks all over them because your cat's been, you know, rubbing against them.
Now, I've seen some people, they rub their cheek against their cat. And they actually do a little play bite on the cat's cheek. Is that good or bad?
I would not do that because your cat could just turn right around and grab your cheek and, you know, bite a pretty big chunk out of you. I would not do that. No.
To say to them, I'm like,
In fact, all right, Max, the new cat I have that's still getting acclimated here, he likes to rub his face against my face. And I'm very cautious when he does it because he's bit me a few times. We're still getting used to each other. So I, you know, make sure, especially if your cat's face is right in front of you, don't stare into his eyes because that's a threat. Don't do that.
Yeah. Now, I noticed you got some no-nos on the toe-toes. What's with the, my cats love their toes played with, but I did it since they were kittens.
Yes, that's the thing is you have to have, when they're young, you have to handle their paws, squeeze their little pads, let the nail come out, you know, so that later on you can clip their nails and touch their feet. But then I couldn't walk up to your cat and do that because that would be a definite no, don't you dare do that because I don't know you, right?
Yeah, right. I like that the poop chute is off limits. I'm glad. But the tip of the tail, what's with the tip of the tail? I'm doing that right now with Rusty. I know, but he trusts me and knows me.
Yeah,
why is this not good?
I have to know you in order for, I can do that too. I can do the tip of the tail, but you know, their tail, that's like their mood barometer, if you watch their tail. All the way down is, you know, don't touch me, or underneath.
Is this a good tail right
this
there?
This is a good tail, especially with a little hook on the end. That is a definite, he loves you.
That's a Rusty the Performer. He's,
I love that.
I think he loves the treats, too.
You need to be careful with the end of your cat's tail, too, because there are a lot of nerves there, and it's usually cartilage or very flexible bone, and sometimes cats' tails get stiffer with age. So you want to make sure that you don't over manipulate your cat's tail also.
Absolutely.
Yes.
So let's go ahead and get off that chart for a second. That was a cool thing. I'm going to show you, this is how Casey likes to be held. I have never had a cat be held like this.
Super
what
cat.
The heck is going on?
He totally trusts you. Totally trusts you. There's not even a question. He loves and trusts you. He's given his all to you. Don't you think, Kathy? Don't you think that's true?
Definitely. Yeah. Well, Rhonda, I had a question for you because, I mean, as cat breeders, you know, we rely on our pet sitters.
Sure.
I mean, they are lifesavers, whereas otherwise we can't leave the house.
Of course. You know?
And I mean, I've had my pet sitter, I've been fortunate, I've had two over the last 35 years. And one of them went through 3 pregnancies while she was taking care of my cats.
Wow, that's impressive.
You know, they also know all the cats in my house. So they know them by name. And sure. Nobody else knows them. If you all, I had several breeds that were all one color. So was there any kind of special relationship you had with your clients? Just like, were you in their will, or were they, or how did you identify the cats if there are multiple cat homes? I mean, you might talk about a little bit about that.
We used a software package, and of course we had all the clients, all the cats that belong to each client attached to the record, and we put pictures so we could tell. We like to send the same sitter as much as possible to each client, but of course, you know, there were times when we had to send a sub, but then we had a dedicated sub also, so we weren't just sending a round robin of people. And if somebody had booked 10 days, they got the same person all those 10 days. We didn't like to, you know, send 4 or 5 different people in, because, you know, you can't spot problems that way if you've got somebody else coming every day.
And you don't know, they don't know the cat's attitude or the behavior or how scared they are, how friendly they
definitely
are. Yeah, so yeah, my pet sitters were always a lifeblood to me, because otherwise I had them sometimes coming 3 times a day when I had kittens.
That's
good.
We have some in
one of the articles that you wrote in Catster. This is a big one because some cats get surrendered. You did an article on litter box behaviors.
Yeah.
And one of them was sleeping in the clean box. Why?
Yeah. Well, I wish I knew exactly why. I think it's probably...
I don't sleep in my toilet.
I know. I know my late Abby, she used to love to just, as soon as I would put the, you know, fresh litter in there, she would just roll around in it. I don't know if she was claiming the box to be hers or if she was just thanking me for cleaning it. I don't really know. It's bizarre.
Well, I think it maybe we're kind of clean and they like it. What about the cats? This is more serious, though. You got to be a pet detective. So what happens if your nice kitty is starting to not use the litter box and is doing it on the rug, either number one or number two? What would your main advice be?
Well, the very first thing I would do is get your cat to the veterinarian to make sure there's not an organic reason. You know, there's not a urinary tract infection, some irritable bowel going on, even allergies, food allergies, flea allergies. Those things can all cause issues like that. And once you get that clean bill of health, then you know you're looking at a behavior issue. Then it comes down to trying to figure out, has something changed in your household?
Good. You know, you got a new cat or somebody they know and love that's left, right?
Right. Or a new person.
It can even be your routine has changed and that has upset them. Yeah. So
I'm wondering if there's been any litter box deviation since COVID. There's your study.
COVID. Well, I know even it's just the dumbest little thing can set a cat off and make them, that's how they protest. But the main thing, though, that I have found is people don't keep the litter box clean enough. As a pet sitter, we went into a number of households where people said, oh, I don't scoop all week, I just dump it at the end of the week. No. Do you want to go into an outhouse that, you know how they get, you know, you're at a fair and you got to go in the outhouse and 10,000 people have used it before you. Do you want to do that? No, but your cat doesn't either. Yeah, exactly. But your cat, he protests in a different way. He'll find a spot.
He doesn't give you the paw. He gives you the poop.
Now, if they defecate on your bed, that's usually a real serious behavior problem. Usually indicative of you've pissed them off, or they're reclaiming you for some reason. Like, I had a friend who got married. She didn't like the husband. The cat didn't like the husband. Started pooping on the husband's side of the bed. So we had to work on that relationship.
Arden, we do have a question from Facebook.
Sure. Who do we got?
Bethany Crum writes, I've got a 5-month-old kitten and she's very playful, but sometimes she gets too rough.
Right.
Do you have any advice?
Well, I'm guessing she's a single kitten. And when you adopt kittens and they're the only cat, the only kitten around, they don't have that sibling to play off that high kitten energy with. Plus, they teach each other good and bad biting behavior. So you kind of have to take that place. And I always say toys are for petting. Hands are for petting, toys are for play.
Yes,
so if you're using the hand to play with them, they think that's okay. They don't know that bite is a bad thing. You have to teach
this them. Is what you
yes,
need.
Yes.
Yeah, I always tell people these are not toys. These are hands.
Yes.
And another thing is you can kind of, if they bite or they go to bite you, you can do the kitten scream.
Yeah. Yeah.
And
oh, do that again. That was pretty good.
That was good.
I've done it for 30 years. They'll know instantly that they've gone too far.
They do. The other thing they respond to is if you do a hiss, because like you throw back to mama, they get it. They know that they stop. They know they've done something inappropriate.
That's a good answer. Hey, you are now on the Pet Life Radio Network, and it's much overdue. Your show, your podcast is called 19 Cats and Counting. Tell us a little bit about your show, how people can tune in.
Well, we started because my best friend and business partner, Linda Hall, she and I, we would be on the phone, you know, we'd be talking about, she has a large cat household too. She had 8, she now has 11. That's a whole nother story. but we would, at the end of our conversations, we'd be like, this could have been a podcast, you know, people could laugh, they could learn something from it. So we just decided we were going to go ahead and do it. And after I was on your show, Arden, I thought, well, I'm going to get brave. I'm just going to reach out to Mark Winter. And we had started our podcast. I think we had 2 or 3 under our belt. And I asked Mark, what does it take? What do I need to do to get on the Pet Life Radio Network? He said, oh, no problem. I can put you on.
Yeah, he's pretty low key. He's pretty low key. I've been doing this for 13 years. He's my radio husband.
I love
you would
him.
Say. So we've done almost 400 episodes. But wow. You started and you've already kicking off. So what's a couple things? How do people? Casey just jumped down from the top of my desk. That was not an earthquake in Dallas. That was Casey. How do people tune in?
You can go to, I have a URL that will go right to the show, 19catsandcounting.com. It'll go right to the show on Pet Life Radio. Also, when I have extra special guests on, like I had Maya Bialik on an episode right now.
Yeah,
we did the video too. So the video to that
Big
is on my
theory,
website.
Guys.
Yeah,
you
and
can
I
actually
just
say her name. Say her name right, because nobody can pronounce it.
Maya Bialik. I love her. She is. I did not know she was such a cat aficionado and advocate for cat health, but she is. She loves her cats as much as she loves her 2 sons.
That's pretty cool.
Not. Yeah.
All right.
I just did Kitten Lady. Hers hasn't aired yet, but as soon as it does, I think it's 3 more weeks, hers will air. I will put the video to that one on my website too. So we're kind of turning into, I have other cat experts, and I also have some celebrities. I try to do a good mix so people are entertained and they get to learn. And of course they hear about all the things that go on in my life and my household with my now 20 cats. 20 is my max. That's why his name's Max.
Sure, 20. But you guys, we've been doing this show and I have not heard a hiss or a yowl or flying cats behind her. So she's the real deal. She is a multi-cat behavior expert and she's living it and she's demonstrated it.
Do we have time for one more question, Arden?
One more question, then we got to get on to the cat breeds.
Okay. This lady says that she has a 1-year-old cat that uses the bathroom in boxes, paper, and fabric rather than the box. They've tried Feel Away, Cat Attract, enzyme cleaners. Is there anything else they can try to help him, encourage him to use the litter box and not other things?
Yeah, there's a couple things. For one thing, where is the litter box? If it's tucked away in a small area or bathroom or something that isn't readily accessible, or he has to run by Fido to get to the litter box. That's a
high traffic area.
Yeah, high traffic areas. They want some peace and quiet, but they don't want to have to go through. I once went to a household where they had the cat litter way in the back in the laundry room. Like in order, I don't know how they scooped it, because in order to get to it, you had to go under a pile of laundry and, you know, all rigmarole just to get to it. And the other cat's not going to use it if it's hard to get to. And how big is the box, right? It should be big enough for your cat to get in and not hang over on either side. You should be able to turn around comfortably. Some cats like lidded boxes. Some don't because they feel, with the lid, some of them feel trapped in there, or they might be getting bullied by other cats, not be able to enter and leave at will. And then I think the last thing you want to think about is the consistency of the litter. You know, is it fine granular that feels okay on the paws? Is it chunky crystal litter, especially if you've got a declawed cat? That's not going to work too well. That might cause some pain. So just evaluate what you're using, how big is the box, and where you're placing it, and put it in
multiple places. I would put up multiple boxes.
Yes,
too.
Yeah, definitely. More than one box. Even if you've just got one cat, I would have at least two boxes.
All right. Well, we've got about 15 minutes left, so I want to give some.
What's this?
I know it's been too good. We're gonna have to have you back, Rita, because you got a lot of good answers. Oh,
thank you. We can do 2 hours, I think.
At this time, it's my honor to introduce an all-breed judge, Ann Mathis. She's gonna talk about the Orientals. I'm gonna undo my video. I'm not being rude. I want you guys to pay attention to her. Okay.
If you're a fan of a long, exotic, elegant cat, the Oriental might be for you. Next slide. Here we go. The Oriental breed is a man-made one. After World War II in England, I believe, in the United Kingdom, they started breeding Siamese to cats of different other breeds to create, and I'm not sure if this was their goal, but we get a Siamese head and body type in fancy pajamas. They come in, you know, so many colors. We'll talk more about that in a minute. The short hair variety first appeared in the U.S. in show rings in the 70s, and the long hair, like at the bottom two pictures, in the 90s. The short hairs have a very short, tight coat that lies very close to their body. The long hairs have a much longer coat, as you can see, but it's not like a Persian coat. It's not as fluffy. It's gonna, again, lie close to the body, but you get that beautiful plume to the tail with the long hairs. The body of the Oriental is long, muscular, and tubular. In a show ring, we want them to be one width, just like a tube that doesn't bulge out in any way from the shoulders to the hips. And we practice. You can see our judge Vicki Nye there holding that white Oriental. And as when you breed these cats, as kittens, you practice holding them like that because the judges evaluate the body that way. You can see that they're, you know, he's perfectly relaxed. They're very used to that. Most Orientals have green eyes. Ones can have blue eyes or they can have odd eyes like the cat in the top middle, but they all have beautiful almond-shaped eyes. The white in the top there has the most beautiful eye shape. It's that almond that slants up along the cheekbones and gives them that very Oriental look. Oh, where am I? Orientals come in hundreds of color variations. We have solids, tabbies, party colors, smokes, shaded, pointed, and all of those colors with white. You probably couldn't own one in each color in your lifetime, no matter how hard you try. It's well over 300 color combinations.
I call it a Siamese in designer jeans.
I always say fancy pajamas.
Yeah.
And you can see this girl.
Go back.
Yeah, sure. The girl on the left is a beautiful Duluth calico, and I think that's an ebony smoke in the middle. When you have a smoke coloration in any breed, it looks solid, and then if you peel the coat back a little bit to look at the root, it's white at the root. And then the beautiful tabbies. I'm sure we have more colors. Most Orientals are very affectionate and friendly. This is the breed that's going to greet you and your guests at the door. They can be quite vocal. So if your idea of a perfect cat is that beautiful cat that lays across the room and doesn't get in your way and doesn't make any noise, this probably isn't the breed for you. You can see in the bottom left picture, they get along beautifully with dogs. I have 3 dogs and they love them. And you can see some babies in the bottom right picture.
They love to cuddle with either you or other cats, so they're good for multi-cat homes. but they also work in a single cat home. They love kids. They just love, they want the attention. They want to curl up with you and be very loving, but they are talkative. They like to talk.
Yes, they are. It's an active breed, but when you go sit down on the couch, you're going to have a cat on your lap. I very rarely don't have a cat on my lap.
Love this little spotted belly.
As they get along, I love the little spotted bellies on the tabbies. Yeah. So cute. Those of us that live with Orientals, their talking is one of the things we love about them. I always say they tell me all about their day.
That's it.
That's it.
Okay, so our trivia question, Anne kind of gave you a little bit of information on it. Our trivia question is going to be about the color classes. Now, when you show your cat, it's shown under what's called a color class. Our trivia question is, how many color classes are there? And there's the same number for the long hairs as there is for the short hair. But the question is, how many color classes? And do not count the AOV, because AOVs are for registration only. They are not for showing. So how many color classes are there for the Oriental breed in CFA? Okay. And what do they win, Arden? I forget. I can't hear you, Arden. You're on mute.
The winner, I'm just teasing. The winner is going to win an amazing gift basket from our sponsor today, from Pet King Brands, Zymox and Oratine. You want to show that photo?
Yeah, I'll show the photo again. Thank you for reminding me.
That's okay. I'm glad I'm no longer doing signs. We want to, let's thank Ann Mathis. Ann, thank you so much for doing the breed profile. I'm laughing because something's happening to my screen. It's falling apart. I have to tape it or something. So just ignore that in the background. But look at this product. They have a lot of great products at Pet King Brands. These are two of their headliners. So we're very happy.
Two from Facebook. So two winners from Facebook. I'll message you. If we're not friends, look for a message from a stranger. But two winners will be chosen from Facebook with the correct answers.
All right. So at this time, we're going to talk about Companion Cat World with Kathy. And everybody, look at my bad screen. I'm not going to spend the last 9 minutes trying to fix it. We can handle it. We're okay. So Kathy, talk about CCW, and then you guys stick around because I'm gonna light this place on fire with my kitty cocktail.
So Rita, our Companion Cat World is our program to register and recognize the non-pedigreed cats. Not all of those are show cats, but some of them are. But all of them can be registered in our program. They get their own membership card with their cat's picture on it, the owner's name and the cat's name, and they have by luggage tags or any kind of things like that to go along with it too. So we recognize the non-pedigreed cats as well as the pedigreed cats. So Companion Cat World was our program to make those card-toting members of CFA. Our organization's been around since 1906, and we want these cats to be part of our organization also. Oh my goodness, Arden, you're having some serious issues.
Set that
place on fire, girl. You didn't want to burn up that screen anyway in case you had a fire get out of control.
We will fix this later, but one of my favorite cocktails to make, and you are now getting to see the inside of Ard's Den. This is my backyard office in Dallas. But one of my favorites is the Flaming Dr. Pepper. Meow! And we all about, it's a drink with a real kitty kick. And so I'm going to light this place up a little bit. So hang on. Let me get my green screen out of the way. Jeez, this is really fun. These are like going crazy. All right. Here we go. Come on, Casey. Just give me a minute while we do. I vacuum too in windows. All right.
So okay, come on north when you get done. You can do my house. Whoops. You just knocked it off.
So you can see this, right, pretty well?
All yes.
Right, so I'm going to do that. So to make a Flaming Dr. Pepper, and I have learned since I moved to Texas that Dr. Pepper came from Texas. It's an original soda from Texas.
Yes,
so to make it, you need amaretto. You need 151 proof rum.
Ooh.
Need your favorite beer.
It burns better.
You need a nice tall shooter glass. And you definitely need a flame. So to make it, you first pour about a cup of your favorite beer.
No Dr. Pepper in it?
No. Chemically, the rum, the amaretto, and the beer make it taste like adult Dr. Pepper.
Oh, interesting.
So you first put about 3/4 on a tall shooter glass with the amaretto. Then you pour about 1/3 of this highly toxic 151 rum. I love
it's not toxic, it's just flammable.
And then you take your gun and you light it. There's the flame.
Is it on fire? Oh, yeah. I can see it. Okay.
And you let it simmer. Now in COVID, each person gets to blow out their own. All right, let me turn this off so I don't burn my house down. And then you make a wish. I wish all cats had the best lives ever.
Absolutely.
Blow it out. Pour it in your cold beer. And at this time, I want us all to raise a glass to celebrate all cats everywhere, whether it's a glass of water you have, soda, everybody raise a glass.
I don't have anything.
Virtual, and this is our time to salute all cats.
Hey, cheers.
Cheers.
And it tastes just like Dr. Pepper with a kick.
That
a
is huge wild. Kick.
Isn't that cool? What do you guys cool. think of this drink? That's one of my favorites.
I'll have to try that.
So again, Robin,
let's talk about your first aid class and next week's guest.
Sure. We have openings for our next first aid class for cats. It's going to be October 18th. And I go ahead and show that slide if you would, Kathy. All right. And three of the people here on the show have all taken and gotten certified in our 2-year veterinary approved cat first aid class. Kathy Black, Rita Reimers, and Teresa Kiger. And these are our four-legged teaching assistants, Rusty the Performer, and Pet Safety Cat Casey. For all of you out there that are also maybe interested, what about the dogs? We do have openings for an October 24th dog and cat first aid class, and that will also include Pet Safety Dog Kona, aka Ice Cream Kona. So please go to Pet First Aid for You. And the latest victim in my class was Teresa. Teresa, what did you think of the class? You took it Sunday.
I had such a good time, and I learned an awful lot. I would highly recommend every cat owner taking this class, because you never know whose life you may save.
Did you like my bad jokes?
I love your bad jokes.
Well, I don't know where my cats are. They've like left the building because I'm destroying it here in Ardstan in the backyard. I want to first let you guys know, next week, our special guest is a celebrity veterinarian, Dr. Lisa Littman, and she's kind of a major deal on Instagram. She's a house call vet, a former ER vet. She lives in New York City. And she's going to be in the house. So she's going to give us tips for cat care. Also, tips on Instagram, which I think is pretty cool.
I know Lisa. I used to be her cat sitter.
Oh, my gosh. All right. Let your friends know. There you go. And also, guys, I want to thank our very, very special guest today, Rita Reimers. She knows cats. Thank you so much for letting me wreck my studio here.
Thanks for including me.
And also Ann Mathis for telling us all about the Oriano. We thank you again for being on the show, Ann. Oh, you're unmute yourself. There you go.
It was fun anytime.
Yeah, all right, you didn't light your house up on fire, did you?
No, I did not.
All right, and again, our special co-pilots, Teresa Kiger and Kathy Black. And we also behind the scenes, Desiree Bobby. Again, thank you, Pet King Brands, for sponsoring this unpredictable show. No cat was harmed in the making of it. I didn't burn down my house. I'm going to enjoy this Flaming Dr. Pepper after the show. And until next time, same cat channel, same cat time. We'll see you on Meowie Hour.
Thanks for joining us, everybody. We'll see, and thank you, Rita. We'll see you next week.